wrong place first. Doesn't the advertising say Santa Monica?
I think so, maybe. I will look into that, though.
Absolutely.
I was on the corner of Arizona and Sentinel.
Sentinella
in Santa Monica.
But you made it here, like,
I know.
After that call. It was amazing.
I know.
Wow. Yeah, so we're obviously extremely joyous that Anne is here, and I'm sure you all know her in some way or another. And I thought just to start off, I'd share a very short story about one of the reasons why we want to have her here. Brian and I were working on a piece about, I don't know, 13 or 14 years ago now, and Anne was our mentor, kind enough to be our mentor, and she came a number of times to our rehearsals. And I think it was about the third time you came, there was a section where we were dancing for quite a long time, fairly heavily. And at the end of that, as a highlight and a shift in dynamic, we became very still. And then we were supposed to stay still for quite a while, and this moment was supposed to have some impact. And so we stopped. We had been dancing for quite a while, and we were breathing extremely heavily. And Anne was witnessing, and just she hadn't said anything to that point. And then just like an arrow, it came into the space, and she said, "Control your breath." And it was as if she had uttered a magic spell, because I think if anyone else had said it, or if she had said it any differently, if she had said, like, "Can you guys control your breath?" or something, I would have said, "No, that's impossible. I'm exhausted and I can't." But she said it and it entered, and by God, it, I controlled my breath. And it was a moment of realizing how the quality of someone's attention, and in a way, what self someone is speaking to, how that can manifest powers that you didn't know you had. And I think this is one of the profound gifts that I've witnessed Anne have again and again and again. And so that connection between an aesthetic eye, knowing in this moment it would be better if you were quieter. And then, you know, just, it wasn't personal. It's just an overarching vast view of, this will be more beautiful. So there's that aesthetic, artistic eye. But then there's also a level of human connection and consciousness that's happening there, where again, someone's connection manifests potential in another human being. And I've never forgotten that. And so that's one of the reasons why I think we wanted Anne to come, this particular power that you have, among many other powers that you have. So I'm wondering if you would share a little bit, just to start, your relationship to listening and your relationship to attention, and maybe how for yourself you work with that skill, if you think of it that way, or...
Well, you've thrown down a gauntlet, which is when you said something which is very intriguing. What are those? Really beautiful at night, right? Yeah. Where you said that that which self are you paying attention to? Mm-hmm. That's an interesting issue. Mm. And maybe I'll just unpack that, because I think it lies at the heart of what you attend to. And I'm thinking of different ways of approaching it. So I'm going to approach it, if you don't mind, in from various directions, and maybe it'll come to talk about attention. First, the first thing I think of is there's a director whose name is Ivo van Hove, and he's has anybody seen his work? He's one of my favorite directors. He's from Holland, and he's actually Flemish. And if you know anything about Holland and Amsterdam in particular, you can do crazy things and get money for it because the government subsidy is so large. Anyway, so he's a really wild director. And he's become very popular in this country, but before he was, the first production he did in New York and in the United States was at the Little New York Theater Workshop in downtown Manhattan. And I went to see it. I was interested. And it was a preview, and it was a pretty full house. And the play started like this. I think it was five actors who walked out on stage and bowed at each other. I think it went like this. And then they bowed to the audience. Mm-hmm. No, they bowed to the audience. They bowed to each other. And then all of them, except for one, moved to folding chairs on the side of the stage. And the one actress who remained, whose name is Joan McIntosh, fantastic actress, took a deep breath and then started speaking at top speed the first eight pages of O'Neill's Impossible Play, at top speed. And I thought, oh, holy! I leaned forward, and I thought, oh, holy cow, oh my God. And I knew that I had to hang on for dear life. And as I was sitting there, breathing as fast as I mean, trying to breathe with Joan, I started hearing the sound, this strange sound you've maybe heard in theaters. It sounds like the it's the sound of people leaving. Mm-hmm. The sound of the, you know, the, when the seats go up, what's that sound it makes?
Yeah.
And within the first 12 minutes of this probably four-hour play, I think about more than a third of the audience, maybe even more, maybe a half, like a lot of people. And the rest of us stayed for what was an extraordinary evening of theater, amazing acting. It changes your breathing, and I think an actor's job is to change your breathing. If I do anything right tonight, I'll start breathing better and change your breathing, and you'll be breathing with me. It isn't happening yet, but maybe if I calm down from being so excited. Now, it was an extraordinary experience, and now I'll go see anything that Eva von Hove does. The way he works with actors is amazing. But it was also a lesson, which is, as an American, as a North American, as a populist, as a Democrat, I'm brought up thinking, how will it go in Peoria, you know? Or will Joe Schmo get it? You know what I'm saying? It's about making sure that everybody's on board. And so usually, and the directors in the room probably know this is true, you think, okay, I'll be really kind in the beginning, and then about halfway through we'll go, wham! We'll hit the audience hard. But Eva von Hove's no, like, we're gonna hit you hard first. And what he was saying is, if you want to stay, this is what's asked of you. And I thought, I don't know if I can do that. I'm an American. I'm about populists. And to this day, I don't think I could start a play like that. I would seduce the audience and then eventually win them over. Now, here's a parallel story. Bear with me. So this even happened longer ago. I was invited by San Diego Rep, it was in 1990, to do a show. And if you know San Diego Rep, it's in a mall, Burton Mall. And I thought, okay, and they asked what play I wanted to do, God bless them. And I thought, okay, it's a play in Southern California in a mall, what should I do? And I decided to do a play that I really love, even though it's a wicked, nasty play. But it's a comedy, you know, for a mall. It's The Women by Claire Booth Luce. A really funny play about nasty women being bitchy at each other. Anyway, I thought that would be great. And I thought, in casting it, we did auditions, I thought, okay, I think it was 16 women, and we decided that decided that every woman I cast, no matter if it was like the third nail polisher from the left, had to also be able to play Medea. That's how it would be. Like, when they walked in for the auditions, I think, could this woman play Medea, even if it was a tiny role? And so we got these 16 fantastic women. And then we got these, this great costume designer. And we worked, it was a love affair. We had a great time working on it, really getting into the nastiness and finding sort of a political statement about women through that, through this nasty, very, very, very funny play by Claire Booth Luce. And we were all excited, and we teched in the mall. And finally, it was the second preview. And all of us in the theater, who's in this room in the theater, you know the horror of second previews, right? Second previews are things you have to live through because they're horrible. They never go well. And this was no exception. Here, I sat there, the second preview, and these 16 fantastic women were doing incredible work, and it wasn't working. And the audience kind of sat there, just like disconnected. You know how horrible that feels. Like there was nothing going on. And that evening, I had to actually get on a plane. I had to go to New York for a reason, win an award, and come back the next day, and I got on the plane. It was a red eye going back to New York for a day, and I was really depressed. And I kept thinking, damn, what am I going to do? I thought, if you can't do The Women, which is a screwball comedy, what's going to happen when the next regional theater calls? Like, what am I going to do, Harvey? You know, like, what plays you have to do to be able to reach out to people? And then I started thinking, I'm going to move to Saratoga Springs, New York, and people are going to have to make pilgrimages to see my work, you know? And then this little word came in my head. It was like, elitist, you know? I thought, I'm too elite for an audience in Southern California in a mall, you know? Anyway, the good news is that it was just the second preview. The rest of the run was great, it was fantastic, it was a love affair, but that night really bugged me. I was really worried, and I started thinking, who's my audience? Who is it? Who am I talking to? And fast forward about 5 months, I had just started City Company, who I hope you'll come to see at the Getty Villa in the coming weeks. I just started, and that summer I was in Japan. Bear with me, I know these stories are rambling. They're all going to come to one point, I hope. And this is after the San Diego experience, where the audience didn't work one night. And I was doing a production of way up in the mountains of Tadashi Suzuki's complex, way up in Togamura in the Japanese Alps, hard to get to, fantastic theater complex. And it was the first year of my company. We were doing Chuck Mee's Orestes. And I didn't know Tadashi Suzuki, who, if you don't know him, he's a Japanese director, has nothing to do with violin. It's like Suzuki, it's like Smith in Japan. Anyway, great director. I was just getting to know him, and we had started this project together, which became City Company. And one day, we were about to have our first run-through in the rehearsal room of Chuck Mee's Orestes. And I was asked if by Suzuki's translator if Suzuki could come and watch a run-through. And I said, sure, why not? And after lunch, and he was going to come after lunch, I didn't know him very well, as I said twice already, I walked into the rehearsal room and I said to the actors, I said, who are all American actors, I said, but they had all studied with Suzuki, so they knew him well. I said, oh, by the way, Suzuki's going to watch rehearsal this afternoon. And they all went, really? And they got nervous. Suzuki padded in very nicely. He had a translation of the play. He sat in the back. He watched the run-through. And at the end of it, he walked out, didn't say a word. But during the run-through, I stood there, because I stand during rehearsals, watching I couldn't stand it. Like, the actors were terrible that afternoon. And it was awful. And the actors were nervous, and they weren't breathing well, and they were bad, and it was bad. And I kept looking at my own work as a stage operator, going, I haven't dealt with that, I haven't dealt with that, I have to fix this. Why is it that this goddamn guy sitting there is making me see all my mistakes and making the actors so bad? And when it was over, he very nicely padded out, never said a word about it. And I was covered with sweat and pissed off. And I took a walk with my friend Leon Inglesrud, who is now in City Company and it was then Suzuki's translator. Go figure, big, huge, red-headed Minnesotan who speaks fluent Japanese. And we went for a walk, and I said, I'm so angry. I said, why is it that when Suzuki walks in the room, everybody turns into mush? And why is it that what happened? And he said, oh, he said, actors know that when Suzuki is looking at them work, and he'll use this phrase, he will say, a professional will see this in your work. That he's looking from the point of view of a professional. So the actors feel that who is watching them is a professional. Do you follow what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And then I had that same thinking going about, as a North American, I don't watch an actor as a professional. Mm-hmm. I watch from, will Joe Schmo get it? Are you with me? So, and it's why this observation you made means so much to me. And what I understood is, no, you don't have an audience. You don't have your own audience. You speak to a certain part of every audience. And if you go back to Ivo von Hove's production where people walked out in droves, every time you go to see a play, in the first minute or 2 minutes, the company is telling you which part of yourself needs to engage. And sometimes if you go to a show that it's just about, they just want the part of me that goes, ha, 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 that's one part of you. Ivo von Hove was asking for a different part of me. I realized that it starts certainly in the director-actor, or direct, in that case, director-dancer, director-performer relationship, where my job is to be the ideal audience. And I learned that the ideal audience is not necessarily a populist audience. An ideal audience is somebody who's watching from a very high level. So what that means, and I remember Martha Graham said once, she was, I mean, I don't remember, I never met the woman, but apparently she was very depressed after her performance and thought it went really badly. And some woman walked up to her and said, I was just at your performance and you changed my life. And she realized if she can reach one person, that somehow that work had spoken to this one person at that moment in her life. And she said, oh, now I know what I'm doing. So the issue is a very big deal. From what self are you watching? And what are you watching for? What self in the actor are you looking? And so what I learned is, A, I don't need to move to some place and be an elitist and have audiences make pilgrimages to see my work. I have to put my work out, but I also have to be clear about what part of each audience member I'm speaking to. Mm. And I need to be clear about it from the beginning. That means I also need to be clear when I'm working in rehearsal with an actor, what part of myself am I watching from? And what do I hope for in this person that I'm attending to? Mm. And is it that I want them to make me feel better? Or is it that I want them to make my ego feel better because they're doing the idea that I came up with? Not so interesting. Is it that I'm wishing for them to do something extraordinary? And the next thing I say, I'm just free associating off of your observation, is, and it's gonna sound a little bit like bragging, but I think it has to do with this issue of attention. It's the biggest compliment I've ever received in my life from anybody. And it was, it's a friend of mine who's an actress named Tina Shepherd. And she used to work with Joe Chaykin in the Open Theater in the old days. She's older than I am. And she lived through those amazing days of the Open Theater. And I was fortunate enough to do a couple of shows with her. The Open Theater was run by Joe Chaykin, great director. And if you haven't read his book, The Presence of the Actor, you haven't lived, write it down, get it. And Tina Shepherd said to me one day, she said, Dan, you and Joe are the only two directors who make me sweat just crossing the stage. And that is the greatest compliment I have ever received in my life. It means that something that I'm doing as a director is asking something of an actor. Not that they do what I want them to do, but that they show me something that thrills me, changes my own breathing, gives me goosebumps, surprises me. That's what I'm looking for. I want something extraordinary to happen. And there's many obstacles to being able to have that happen. Mm. And most of them have to do with ego. Mm. But again, that issue that you brought up is key, which is how do you pay attention and what are you paying attention to? What part of yourself are you working from? Because ultimately, that's the part that you're speaking to in terms of an audience. If I'm the first audience, if I'm the litmus paper for the actors to test what they're doing against, how do I attend to what they're doing?
Mm-hmm.
How can I be that audience for them?
Mm.
You see how that all comes together in the movie?
Mm.
So when I don't remember this moment.
I do.
That matters a great deal, and now I'll remember it because you told it in a story. But that would be true. I'm just kind of remembering it now, but I wonder if I'm manufacturing the memory. You were just making too much noise. But that said,
it's true.
The older I get, the more I realize that breathing is everything
mm-hmm.
in acting. Where you place a breath, how you breathe, where you put a catch breath. And that usually when you're unsure, scared, and if you don't know your lines well enough, you take a lot of catch breaths in the wrong place.
Mm-hmm.
And what you have to understand is that your job, right now I haven't breathed in a moment, so I'm gonna now play with you. I'm not breathing, I'm not inhaling, and I'm getting a little upset, and I'm also engaging. And I bet you all just inhale a little bit with me right now. So I'm not really an actor, so I can't do it very well, but you can play with the audience's breathing. And that's the reason I'll never make a film. Because
mm.
that interests me too much. That thing that happens in the room, that happens amongst us.
Mm. Mm. Did you find when you made this discovery about what you're looking for, who's your audience, right? Or what you're speaking to in the audience,
uh-huh.
did that shift, was that something in yourself where you went, oh, well, I immediately know what it is to look from a professional, or did you actually find that you created a different space in your own being to watch
from? You know,
from?
It's a long process. I mean, I'm still trying to do that.
Mm-hmm.
It's not something one gets to.
Mm-hmm.
I think it involves a great deal of study, awareness, experimentation, trying things out, that's experimentation. But no, it doesn't just all of a sudden happen. You have to understand your position in the room as a director, certainly.
Mm-hmm.
What's my job? And I'll share with you something that's a little gross. But it's a good metaphor, which is that my job is to, as I said a moment ago, is to be the litmus paper for the actors. So in other words, they have things to do and they try it out on me. And I'm the first one. It's not necessarily the stage manager who's sitting nearby me or the sound designer, it's me. I'm the target. And then at a certain point, I can actually open it up to others, that the actors are ready to take on others. But here's my gross analogy, which is, it's a like pregnancy paper, like pregnancy test. You pee on it and see if it changes color. So my image is that the actors are peeing on me and seeing if I change color. That's my job. They're peeing on me and I either change color or not. And they can tell how they're doing. Not necessarily by me saying, oh great. They can feel the level of my excitement. So my job is to be hyper present to what they're doing in the moment. Open to, well, that's what an actor does too. What an actor has to be in the moment, ready to change, ready to be tickled by something. The art of an actor is to be able to differentiate one moment from the next.
Mm.
So I have to be able to do that too, is to not be in the moment before, but to be in the particular moment and be able to change and be able to respond genuinely. Because an actor can also sniff it out right away. The minute you stop doing that, or you get stuck on your own idea again, or ego, I think.
Mm-hmm. How do you keep yourself present?
How? Well, you can breathe. Well, actors have training, and directors have to find their own training.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't train with the actors, but I have my own training,
mm-hmm.
which is, you know, a lifetime of various methods, all of which have been very useful for me to stay present.
Mm-hmm.
Can you name some of those?
Yeah, I mean, a lot of them are martial arts. I started out 40 years ago studying Tai Chi Chuan. I still do that. I studied Aikido for about 25 years. I did yoga then when my knees were wrecked from Aikido, I went to yoga for a long time, and then I'm back to Tai Chi. But that's just, it could be many, many things. But that's a training you practice every day that helps you stay in the moment. But it's also the practice of rehearsal, of being present. Is not doesn't just happen when you're practicing, but all the time.
Yeah. So you just, that's causing me to think of, I think it was John Cage said something about that theater is happening all the time and art just helps us to recognize it.
Yeah.
You know, in that sense of, and when I think about those disciplines, the martial arts and so forth, there's such an integration of the physical and the mental, you know, the body and mind, and kind of being in that sweetness or whatever you want to call it that makes you feel present. And I know that's something that, you know, when people are coming to the center, that seems to be a fundamental thing as to whatever's going on in their life, whatever it is that they do. It's, you know, what can I do to facilitate not only but being present, but also being okay or accepting what's going on, which I think is something that when you talk about you've accumulated this training in life to create something as an artist, which is a reflection or an intimation or an observation or an insurrection of these moments in life, it seems to be that almost the fundamental core aspect of it is like how present is the audience, are the actors, everyone involved.
But it also, for me, the martial arts aspect has was also, in addition to being present, it helped me deal with really big problems, like boards of directors. So practicing Aikido is a really great.
You just roll them.
Yeah, you take their energy and you go, yeah.
Should, yeah.
Can you, so when you are practicing, and I think there's something, when you talk about creating your own practice, or you're saying as a director, you had to figure that out for yourself, which can be quite daunting, and I think even as a performer, there's often a feeling like you're trying to sense, you know, what's really going to be beneficial in your, and it changes as you grow older, and so both in your own practice, and then also when you're witnessing a piece come together in the creative process, how do you know how long to stay with something? Because a practice, sometimes, you know, things don't come right away. And so I think there's some particular power of discernment to sort of sense this trail is worth continuing, even though I'm not sure where it's going to go or it may not lead me anywhere. And then there are other paths that you have a sense, you know, that this isn't, you know, almost right away sometimes, you know, or you've gone too far and you're like, wow, I spent a long time on that and it didn't take me. So I'm just interested
you're
in your
just
own
describing
sense
the last week.
Oh.
All those things happened in rehearsal in the last week.
Yeah. So how or where do you sense for yourself when to make a shift and when to keep pressing on with something even though you're not sure if it's going to take you?
Did you use the word sense? When
sense.
Do you sense? Yeah, that's how you do it.
Uh-huh.
It's not intellectual. You know when it's wrong, and you know when to wait. I don't know anything about fly fishing, but I imagine that's the same thing, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, you have to.
There's a lot of waiting involved.
Waiting,
and hunting.
Yeah.
And
well, my colleague, and friend, the playwright Chuck Neave, said that the director is the person in the room who can live with the intolerable the longest. In other words, everybody wants a fast fix, but the director's the one who can wait the longest, which makes it sound like the director's job is just to wait until things happen. That's also not it. It's a very tricky paradox. You have to act decisively, but you also have to know how to wait. And I would say my primary core value as a director is collaboration, which means that I have to learn how to allow the room to be full of the people who are in it, if you understand what I mean. Meaning, it's not about people doing what I want them to do. Mm-hmm. It's about us finding a way to create together and find the solutions that the play wants. Mm-hmm. not what I want, not what you want, but what it wants, which takes a certain kind of patience. And yet, as you say, that's no good. But no,
don't waste any
go
time
there.
On that.
Just no. And here we spend a long time, and it could be a dead end. Mm-hmm. And certainly, as I say, we're in the final third of rehearsals for the Persians up at the Getty Villa, and going through all of those things right now, because as you know, it's a tricky, tricky play. And what is it? Mm. What is the fine sculpture inside of this big stone? Mm. You know, and it takes a massive amount of patience and courage to do that. So,
No, we were talking about collaboration and really how extraordinary it is that you have had collaborators for 20 some years now that you've been working consistently with, and what a gift and I'm sure a challenge that is. And so
yeah, both.
And I'd love for you to speak to. So you have the quality of attention that you have when you're witnessing, but then these are also people that you know so deeply well, and is there a space that you create to see them afresh, and how do you do that? Or do you have a sense of, okay, like, do you find yourself falling back on, I know this person and I know what they can do? And is that beneficial or does that hinder you? And then, you know, are you able to offer them, I remember at one point, and I often repeat this, of the many Anne comments that I repeat through the years that I was able to be around you, was you said that the greatest gift that you can give someone is the ability to change. And I also have never forgotten that. And I find that outside of art, I think about that just with other beings to hold the space for them to grow. I'm just thinking about that.
Well, you just answered it. Okay. I would have said exactly the same thing.
Those are your words.
Which is, but I'm sure they're not original. I have very few original thoughts. I study a lot and I use everybody else's scores. So absolutely, it's after 22 years with the same company, it's always the issue is to look with fresh eyes. But some of the acting members in the company, the actors, and some of the designers, the reason I love staying with them is that I don't recognize them. I look at Will Bond on the stage, I don't know who he is after 22 years. I look at Ellen Lauren on the stage, I don't know who he is. Tom Nelly, I mean, I look at these people and I genuinely, after all these years, I don't know who they are. And that keeps me really thrilled. But I want to bring up something else about that, which I think is not talked about so much. Why people stay. And it's going to sound crass, but true. When I founded City Company with Tadashi Suzuki in 1992, one of the first decisions I made is that these actors must be paid decently. Mm. I didn't, and because a lot of people start companies today, they say, okay, we'll pay the actors when we get our feet under us. We'll pay for the heat, the electricity, we'll pay for the if we need a musician, we'll pay for the realist, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. But it's only afterwards we'll pay for the actor. They said, no. One of the high priorities with City Company from the beginning was that the actors are paid decently. And I mean a living salary. And in 1992, that was $800 a week. They have to be paid that. They're artists, they're people. Now, that's not to say that it was always able to achieve it. And it also meant that I lost a lot of opportunities in the beginning. Mm-hmm. Because we would get, I remember we did, as I mentioned, Orestes in Japan, and then we did it in Saratoga Springs, where we are every June, as some of you know very well. And then we were offered to bring it to New York by On Guard Arts' Annie Hamburger, and I said, well, how much can you pay the actors? And she said, $200 a week. I said, no fucking way, no, I can't do it. So I lost that opportunity. There were many like that. And it's also true that there were moments when the actors would vote and say, we really want to go to Tbilisi, and we're going to lose money, and we'll do it, you know. And we couldn't raise our own bond in the beginning. A bond, you know, for an equity company is a lot of money. Mm. And it was, it, you know, and then these, but things happen. If you make that kind of decision, You figure it out. I remember a friend of mine, Moises Kaufman, had just made a lot of money on his Oscar Wilde play, and he gave us the money for the bond. God bless him. You know, and he was just starting out with Tectonic, too, right?
Wow.
So we made the bond, and we were able to pay him back. So a lot of the reasons the actors stay may be partially because of quality of attention, but it's also because they're paid decently.
But that's part of the quality of attention.
You're
talk about
right.
seeing someone
yeah.
as a professional.
You're absolutely
You say,
right.
you know, your work
yeah.
is valuable, you're a
yeah.
professional, and I'm going to honor that.
Mm-hmm.
And that includes quality of attention and economics,
yeah.
it seems.
Yeah, so you're absolutely right. It is a quality of attention.
Yeah.
But it's also a decisive decision that makes a difference in the long run.
Right.
And that's always the first thing to do is, in any process, is to say, what are your priorities? What do you care about most? Because you can't have everything.
Mm-hmm.
You say, number one, they're paid decently. Number two, or maybe, number one, it has to be collaborative, or I'm not interested.
Mm-hmm.
No, I don't want to go there if it can't be that. So what are way up there? And then a lot of other things can go away, things that you think you value. You say, it's fine.
Hmm.
So.
I so love this aspect about viewing someone who you've been around and worked with for years and having this sensibility of mystery
mm-hmm.
with them.
Yeah.
And maybe that's something, you know, maybe just to explore that a little bit about how one goes to kind of cultivate the way I would be translating that would be this kind of spaciousness as to there is definitively a body and a certain level of ego that's showing up in the room to be serviceable. But then from your role and then from, let's say, the actor's role, this sense of spaciousness that it seems that you both are kind of cultivating at the same time. Like, mm-hmm. let's create some space here, you know, so that something then can arise and enter and catch fire and so
mm-hmm.
forth. And I don't know, you know, for you in that process, you know, what is it maybe that you perceive of the actors doing?
Yeah,
the
word egos come up a lot, right? You need simultaneously, either as a director or as an actor, for any artist, you need a huge ego and no ego simultaneously. And so the actors that I mentioned, Will Bond, Ellen Lauren, Kelly Martin, you know, those are people who have huge egos. I mean, massive, monumental egos. But they also have no ego, and it's amazing. And they let shit go.
Mm-hmm.
The uninteresting ones are the ones who are holding on tightly to who they were last week, if you know what I mean.
Mm.
Or proving themselves all the time, that they have some sort of worth.
Mm-hmm.
These are people who are astronauts. Speaking of astronauts, what are the secrets to directing? No, it's more the secret to acting. So the image I have is like, speaking of astronauts, so the actor is the astronaut, and I'm in the control tower. And so the actor's out in space, and I say, go to the right. And they go, whoa. I go to the left. Whoa. So that's our relationship. But what's interesting is that what they're doing is not for themselves. It's for Earth in this case. They're doing it for others.
Mm-hmm.
And my job is to make them visible to others.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know how I got on that.
Mm-hmm.
I just said astronaut. I wanted to share that with you. You want to know another secret to acting? Not so much? Yes?
You got to really want it.
My dear Rena heard this too well. I like this figure. It's good, though. I think you'll like it. So I think that acting is the balance between feed forward and feedback. Feed forward, you know, in cybernetics, feed forward is the feeling you have if you're playing volleyball, and if the ball's coming at you, you go out at it. So that's called feed forward. Feedback is the sensation you receive from having an experience. So the balance of that is key. So, for example, I never like actors who have too much feet forward. You've seen them, they're all like this. That's too much feet forward. I don't like actors who have too much feet back. Strasberg. Okay, I'm gonna remember my dog dying. Okay, I got the feeling of my dog dying. And now I'll say the words to you. Which actually works very well on film. It doesn't really work in the theater. Mm. I also call that solipsism. So an actor who has too much, or narcissism. But the balance of those two, enough feet forward, enough courage to go out to have an adventure, and then, like the astronaut, to have the experience in front of an audience is the deal. Now, I watched, you know, that horrible TV program called Inside the Actor Studio with that slimy man, James Lipton, you know.
How do you really feel about that?
I think he paints his... He's so slimy and unctuous. Anyway, but I do watch it. he had the creators of Will and Grace on once, and at one point he asked the I don't remember his name, the guy who created Will and Grace, the TV program, he said, how did you come up with the name? And the creator said, Martin Buber. And James Lipton said, what do you mean? He said, Martin, the will to go out and the grace to receive. And I thought, bingo! And of course I went out and got all Martin Buber, started reading, which is worthwhile doing. The will to go out and the grace to receive. And I think that is what makes an actor unforgettable. When I say I don't know who they are, they have the courage or the will to go out into outer space, and the grace to receive it. So I, as an audience, can actually have the sensation of their experience, viscerally, physically. Now, to do that is not so easy.
Makes me think that a counterpart that's important is the audience has to do the same thing, right? Like they have to have the will to be able to actually first show up, actually come to the theater, come on time, and you know make that effort in their life. But then to actually witness, and then to be able to receive, and I find so often it's, you know, to find that balance is tricky. Either the audience is like, all right, show me something, you know, or they're sort of, you know, they're there, but nothing.
I pay so much money.
Yeah,
give
like
it
I do
that. Give it to me. That's too much for you.
Well, sort of like the Broadway audiences where it's like, you know, I paid $125. I love this show. I love it. You know, even if they didn't get anything in. And
I'm so glad you brought that up. It's I hadn't actually extended the thought to the audience, but that's absolutely true.
But I wonder
the
how.
The will to go out and the grace to receive.
So how do you? I mean, I'm intrigued by this now too because I'm thinking so. If the quality of the performers and the director and the process is such that there's a balance, does that gift that possibility to the audience to attune them? Will they tune in, like you're talking about the breathing changing? Can they tune in and find that?
Well, you know, I hate Irish plays. I hate them all. I hate them all. I hate every Irish play ever written. And I went to see one on Broadway recently. I'm now a Tony voter. Thank you very much.
Oh, fantastic.
It's insane. It's like, I used to hate Broadway, and now I have like a kid in a candy shop. I'm like, oh, this is great! Anyway, but I went to see an Irish play. What's the name of it? It's the new Shanley. I'm going to get to
know.
Your answer your question. Michael, what's his name?
Patrick Shanley.
It's his new play, and it's super Irish. It's called...
Is it called Super Irish?
It's his newest play, and I went to see it on Broadway. It actually had... a TV actress who turns out to be amazing, Deborah, she was on the two gay guys TV
Messing?
Show. Deborah Messing.
Oh, Deborah Messing.
She's really good. Mm. Anyway, it has Deborah Messing in it and Brian O'Byrne, and they were speaking with Irish accents, and I hate Irish plays because they always happen in kitchens or bars, and they're just drunk, and they, anyway. So this was like, and they always have ugly sets, you know, those. Anyway, this had an ugly set, and they were speaking in Irish accents, and it was in a kitchen, and they were drinking. And I thought, oh shit, my heart sank. But then there were three moments, and it was directed by Doug Hughes, and there were three moments that transformed me completely, and I didn't expect it. Here it was in a Broadway house. Three moments where the, and I think it was the grace of the actors and the director and the play, where they stopped. And it's a little bit like the cliche, you can hear a pin fall. But this whole Broadway house that, yes, it paid too much money, and the stupid ugly set and the stupid story, one was a moment between Brian O'Byrne and the guy playing his father, who was about to die, and the guy was in bed, and they just stopped. We all stopped. We all got lifted into the air. And another happened between Deborah Messing and Brian O'Byrne, where they stopped. We didn't know what was going to happen next. I could feel it. I think that, as little as I expected it, is the grace of the theater, where we all arrive in the same spot. And I remember something, you know, a friend of mine who's an actor who worked with Peter Brook in Hamlet was playing the best friend, what's his name?
Horatio.
No, not
Horatio.
Is that the guy? The best friend?
The brother is
the brother, yeah. And I said, what was it like to work with Peter Brook? And he said, well, the rehearsals weren't so interesting. He said, but what was interesting is that Peter's genius is to know right where to place you, so all you have to do is be very present and the audience will come to you. And I thought,
that's pretty
good. That thing, or what happened in those three moments in that play, his name I can't remember.
Outside
Mullinger, you just looked it up on your Outside Mullinger. Where we all arrive in the same place. I think of my favorite expression of this thing that you're talking about was said by Alfred Brendel, who's the great pianist who plays Beethoven's sonatas so beautifully. And he said in an interview, he said that when he is in concert playing a Beethoven sonata, he gets to the moment before the final chord, he lifts his hands, and he asks silently the audience how long they will let him wait before he does that. And I thought, that is why I'm in theater. That thing, or that moment where we're all together, is why I'll never do film or television. That place, which is sacred.
Why do you say sacred?
I don't know. What's the definition of sacred? You better look it up.
Set apart. Something that's set apart.
Is that what it is?
Mm-hmm.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's cool. It's sacred. Yeah, it's set apart. That moment, those three moments in that Broadway house, or I imagine the moment with Alfred Brendel, or the moment of Horatio, where somehow he put his hand out, like his hand was in the right place. Find that spot. Mm-hmm. Is it a sweet spot or something?
Mm-hmm. I'm just
thinking
now.
It's really apart, set apart?
Yes.
That's.
And then you have to go set apart from what? But
yeah.
But you know, when you were talking about feedback, you said the word solipsism and narcissism, but then you were using the word grace, and I'm thinking those are different.
Oh yeah.
So.
Yeah.
But we were sort of speaking about them in the same, so I just want to unpack that, you know,
the
difference
between. No, I'm speaking negatively with solipsism and narcissism.
But it's the same, would you say it's the same energy stream, but it's what's running on it, or how would you talk
about
that?
I'm saying that the grace is the space in between, in between going out and receiving.
I see.
That relishing your own sensation for yourself, I call solipsism, and it's not useful or helpful. That doesn't mean that pleasure isn't helpful, but pleasure in service of what? Or how is it connected to the world? You know?
Thank you, that's helpful.
Should we ask any questions since you just said the world?
Oh, yeah.
Brian put a big question on here.
Did I?
Yeah, I read it and I went, wow, that's a big question.
I'm scared.
I'll read it.
Okay.
What do you think it means to be a human being in the 21st century? We could just read it and go on. We could do something else.
No, of course not.
But it goes to the service to the world that I'm connecting.
I I think that the 21st century for in this part of the world, the biggest issues are how to relate to other parts of the world, mm-hmm. and how to handle the slavery of technology. Like how you can stay human within the time signature of the internet. It's tricky, isn't it? How do you negotiate those waters? And how do you negotiate the fact that we are tied so, literally tied to the greatest, as I heard the other day on the radio, the greatest biblical exodus mm-hmm. in a long time in northern Iraq. Those people running up the mountains, how do you relate to that? Mm-hmm. And we are related to it. Mm-hmm. And to negotiate those waters is what perhaps keeps you human. Because it's so easy to be swept into the forced time signature of our time, which is always getting faster, mm-hmm. and find deliberate slowness in that. Mm-hmm. How? And that struggle is a noble one, but how to stay awake?
Oh. Have you found you've been able to do that while engaging? I mean, I find for myself, my first tactic is I just turn everything off a lot. But
yeah.
But I'm trying to find a space where I can have things on and be engaging. But it is such a powerful entity.
Well, you're in a similar situation. I have the grace of being in rehearsal 8 hours a day,
mm-hmm.
which is a time for me that is not connected. That is about being in the room with other people.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a choice I've made. And that's a huge thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I am the first person to jump on the internet and find out, you know, what John Patrick Shanley's latest play was. I'm gonna do that right away. And I love it, and it's totally addictive and fantastic. So
mm-hmm.
I have the benefit of 8 hours of rehearsal.
Yeah.
Or when I teach at Columbia, I have these amazing 3-hour sessions with my students
mm-hmm.
where we're just together.
Mm-hmm.
So, but that's again a choice.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm. It's so striking to think about how what seems to be completely worthwhile being in that space where you're all together, that you felt in seeing the stupid Irish play. You know, being in that space, and that it seems as though one of the things you were pointing at was when they stopped, so that there was a cessation there, that it seems as though the silence was actually revealing more, or almost doing nothing was revealing more.
Yeah. You know, that's the key, that's the secret to theater.
So many secrets you're letting out tonight. Thank
I'll
you.
I'll tell you any secrets.
I was very, very, very fortunate to see the work of a genius before he died of AIDS in the, I think it was like 1981. I saw a production of a puppeteer by the name of Robert Anton.
Mm-hmm.
And he died tragically early. Why I was fortunate is he only let 18 people see his show at a time,
mm-hmm.
because he worked in tiny little puppets.
Mm-hmm.
And I learned one of the greatest lessons about the theater that relates to this issue.
Mm-hmm.
And I was one of the 18. I was very fortunate to see it. What he had is he had built like a mountain on a table, like about this size, and on it were castles, and his puppets were medieval with porcelain faces. They were finger pick puppets, beautifully rendered, with amazing clothes. And he's told these stories that were fantastical, full of romance, big stories with these tiny little puppets. 3/4 of the way through this show, which was probably an hour and 20 minutes long, he took the puppets off and he did a scene between two fingers.
Mm-hmm.
And it was heartbreaking.
Mm-hmm.
And it was one of the greatest lessons I've ever learned, which is that's the point. Now, he couldn't have done that
mm-hmm.
in the first quarter of his show, right? That wouldn't have worked. It would have been two stupid fingers. But if you're brought to a point where
mm-hmm.
Doug Hughes and Patrick, where the puppets come off, where we are left with the imagination, with communication, with expression,
mm-hmm.
that's the point. So the secret that I'm talking about of the theater, and it's not the secret of film and television, it's actually the opposite of the secret of film and television. The secret of the theater is to find out how little you can do on stage so that the audience is doing most. So it's a process of taking away, of subtracting, of finding the essence so that more is happening in the audience's imagination. And that's the search. How little can you do? And can you find a moment where we're all present? I hope we can find one for Persians. We haven't found it yet. Or maybe we have. Maybe there's one.
There's
doing a show
right
called
now.
Persians by Aeschylus, the first play. Oh, this is something else, though, in your question about the audience
mm-hmm.
and about creating that space. In doing Persians, because it's the first extant play in the West, I thought, oh, well, what we should do is create the big bang of the birth of theater, of course, because before the Persians, let's pretend there was no theater,
mm-hmm.
at least no tragedy. There was a lot of performance.
Mm-hmm.
And then Persians, it's not really true because the Persians was actually a later play of Aeschylus. It's just the only one we have. But in my brain, I said, let's pretend like it's the first play ever. So can we, up there on the hill of Getty, create the big bang? Can we create theater being born? So then I had to study for months and months and months the birth of theater. And a lot of people have a lot of opinions. But one thing that I learned that I found fascinating, and it relates to this issue of the audience and
mm-hmm.
the audience's attitude, what they bring,
mm-hmm.
their will and their grace, is that probably tragedy emerged from sacred ritual, from tragedia. Goedia, it comes from the word goat. It was where you killed goats
mm-hmm.
as part of a sacred ritual. One of the many, many things I found was interesting is that these rituals were sacred, a place apart, and audiences were not allowed. So there was no audience.
Mm-hmm.
It was an enactment.
Right.
And the dithyram, the dance in the circle, all came from that.
Mm-hmm.
And at a certain point, an audience was allowed in and became the audience. And this is what I find fascinating, that audiences were probably so thrilled they were going to see something secret that they came with that attitude
mm-hmm.
of, oh my God, I'm going to be let in on a secret.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Now, how can we can that and use it?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, how could we come back to that
mm-hmm.
quality of curiosity? You know, that they brought that with them.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh, that must have been a great audience. Where they went, oh, you're going to let me see? Finally, I can see what's been going on behind
mm.
everybody's backs.
Mm.
I don't know how to do that.
Huh. Makes one of my teachers, Anna Halperin, remember her telling me the story of she was exploring other types of theater in the sense of sacred rituals, and she was spending time with Native Americans, and she was going to their dances, and she said she was there and she was watching, and you know, she said they go on for hours and hours and hours, you know, and she's a American, and so she's there and she's standing there, and she'd been there for hours, and she thought, you know, I've been doing a really good job, and witnessing this, and she got a little tired, and for a moment she said she shifted her weight back and turned, And this older Native American woman who was sitting next to her took a stick and smacked her on her leg.
Oh my God.
And she still has a scar there.
That's so great.
As if to say, you're going to ruin the entire thing.
That is amazing.
By doing that.
Oh, I got one for you. Now, that is great. That's great. This is my favorite director in the world is a woman named Ariane Mushkin, who runs a company called Le Théâtre du Soleil that has nothing to do with Cirque du Soleil in Las Vegas. It's Paris. She has this fantastic company, and I've gone for, you know, most of my life made the pilgrimages to Paris to see her work, or sometimes she comes to this country, came to LA in 84. And she's the you know, you have to have a model in your life, and she's the woman I look to and say, this is my person. And I had a student from Peru at Columbia, Gisela Cardenas, and she came to Columbia, she was my student, and she came up to me and she said, you know, I just got a letter from the Théâtre du Soleil in Paris. Apparently, 3 years earlier, she had written asking if she could participate in a workshop with Ariane Mushkin and the Théâtre du Soleil. 3 years later, she got a letter saying, okay, you can come in January. She said, can I go? I said, are you kidding me? So she went and she participated, and when she came back, I said, okay, tell me everything. What did you experience? And she said, well, I'll give you an she said, there were 200 people in the workshop, so that meant that most of the time you're watching. And she said, Ariane Mushkin would work with about 3 or 4 actors on the stage. They would, the actors would know basic situation, who their character was, what they were after, all that stuff. They would improvise. And she said, one day, 200 people watching, 3 or 4 actors on the stage, Ariane Mushkin and the actors were having a really hard time. They were struggling. And finally, Ariane Mushkin, who was very frustrated, turns around to the workshop participants of 200 and says, if you don't wish with every ounce of your being for our success, I cannot go on. Similar, right? And Gisela Cardenas said this was the hardest work she's ever done for the rest of that day, was to wish. And there's something in that, right? I mean, you say, do sporting events go better because of the fans? You know, what is the investment of an audience? I know an actor knows this. Any good actor on stage knows the audience gives them a certain amount of permission. And the audiences, some audiences give more permission. I also know, and I hate quoting David Mamet, who I hate, but he's very smart. He said, an audience learns from one another how to watch a play. That's interesting, right? There's a lot in this recipe to what it means to be an audience and how does an audience relate. But that notion of an audience wishing for the actors to do well, or Anna Halperin losing her concentration for a minute, that's a great story.
Yeah.
It's great.
I mean, it makes me think about how this sense of personal responsibility, you know, it's sort of overwhelming when you think about, you know, to have some woman hit you and say, you're going to ruin this entire ritual because you looked away for a moment.
Yes.
We don't have that. You know, as Americans, we're sort of like, we're very passive about our...
Well, it explains one of my pet peeves in the theater. Like, I could shoot an audience who does this, either in my play or if I'm seeing one. If I see an audience do this...
Oh.
I could, like, stab them in the back. I hate them. And that's weird, because I don't mind if an audience gets up and leave. I don't mind if they eat. I don't mind if they yell. But if they do this, I get in my stomach. I just want to kill them.
What is it about that particular?
Well, I had to analyze that.
You got it.
It goes back to the word narcissism. What are they thinking about in this moment?
Their neck.
What are you thinking about?
Yeah.
What are you attending to? I actually have to tell my assistant tomorrow to stop doing that. She's driving me crazy.
Oh, wow.
She does this all the time. It's like,
she's lucky you haven't stopped her yet.
Yeah, I was thinking, well, I can't stop her. She's just, like, sore from sitting so long. But I think I'm going to do it.
Well, but it's interesting because it goes back to that first story I told, because I think, you know, in that moment when we were out of breath, I was attending to my own body. And what you called upon, the challenge in the quality of your voice and your attention, actually allowed me to raise above my body in a certain way. And I don't mean in a sense of dominating my body in a negative way, but actually to say, no, I can control my breath. I don't need to breathe heavily here. I can attend to something else. And just that, you know, knowing that you could shift your attention and attend to something else is something we forget.
You know, I think there's another part to that story, too, that relates to the relationship in that moment, our relationship in that moment, which is empathy. In other words, when you say I had the right tone of voice, I know how hard it is to control your breathing. So I wasn't saying it like
Yeah, you're a bad person.
I mean, my favorite American director in the world is Robert Woodruff. And he'll say things to an actor like, oh, man, you got, look at what you have to do. Oh, man, that's really hard. No, go ahead. And so the people love working with him because he's got empathy. So that notion of like, where from yourself? What self are you watching from?
Yeah.
And do you have empathy with what the actor has to do? I have so little ability to do with what actors can do. I can't do that. I'm not physically gifted as much as I study and train. And I admire them, but I have such awe for what they can do, and if they can do it without breathing hard, you know. So I think you felt that also, and
yeah,
empathy,
absolutely.
not a derogatory or judgmental point of view. It's like, boy, if you could do that.
Yeah, no, just do, you know, do it. We're both here to do it for this other thing. So
yeah.
Step up. Yeah.
That consideration. I mean, this kind of. This whole depth of consideration, whether it's when you were talking about the ordinary Joe in Peoria, when you were attuning your sense of consideration of that kind of that individual versus starting to break that down more specifically, it seems to keep coming back to this, which is whether if there's the emotional component of empathy, or there's sometimes if it's an intellectual one of that, oh, I need to consider this and where this person is coming from, or if it's the actor who's floating out in space, but they at heart have the earth in mind. There is this self-awareness, but it's always in relation, it seems to be.
Yeah.
You know, and if that's cut off in some way, then that's probably when the air really goes out.
And if it's cut off, then you get that word solipsism.
Right.
It has to be connected to something.
Yeah.
True.
Other than yourself.
Other than yourself, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Huh.
Yeah.
Do we want to take a pause, or should we just do...
Sure. Well, yeah, why don't we take a break for what?
So why don't we take let's take a pause for... Is 5 minutes okay for people?
5 minutes.
Okay, just so we can have as much time as possible. So five... And